So Azeem, great to see you here in Davos. It's a little bit chilly.
It's chilly, but it's wonderful to be here. Your company is warming me up.
That's great to hear. That's great to hear. But finally, we meet in person.
Yes.
Tons of activity. You're my go-to AI guru.
Thank you.
What are you seeing out there in terms of 24? Any big surprises? Did anything change for you as you with incoming perceptions versus what you're hearing and as you look at 24?
Well, the big surprise for me has been hearing directly from company bosses about how they're using AI, both at a dinner that you hosted, but also in the official annual meeting. I'm surprised at how far large companies are in deploying not just traditional AI, but generative AI as well. And also the sense that they've only just begun to do it. So that's big surprise number one. I think the second thing that I was very pleased to see was that the World Economic Forum has been able to bring representatives from all of the key foundation model makers and the key scientists and get them in a room together to start to talk about your practical, tangible issues of what comes next.
Love it. And I love that the tech leaders are actually embracing that conversation. They're not shying away from it. Is that same sentiment that you feel?
Yeah, I think that they are definitely embracing it. We always have to be a bit careful with technology firms because they always have their own agenda. And sometimes that agenda is a simple commercial agenda that you can look at. And sometimes it's also about some really fundamental beliefs. And one of the points of distinction that is emerging is around the extent to which models should sit behind APIs, sit behind proprietary doors, the extent to which they should be open source and fine-tunable, what is better for industry, what is better for society at large, because this is a powerful technology. And there is still, I think, a sort of enough creative disagreement about those types of issues.
Okay. Then that's your role to keep us on our toes and make sure that it's the overall productivity, right, of the workforce, et cetera. So how do you frame that conversation when you're talking about it? And is it real? Is it not real?
Well, the technology is so general and it can be applied in so many different ways. Its power is in its generality. And in a way, when you start to pull out specific use cases, you actually weaken the promise of generative AI. And what I love to think about is the way in which my team has started to use this. We use it for desk research. We use it for analytical thinking. We use it for creative thinking. We use it to automate our marketing analysis. And where do you begin? Where do you start? And when you talk to bosses of companies with 50, 100,000, 200,000 employees, they're in a similar situation because every employee has got four or five different unique use cases that can come to bear. I'm quite optimistic that over the course of this year, where firms have been a little bit slower to roll things out so they can make sense of the technology, they will widen participation across their organizations. And then the question really will be, will that productivity, those productivity gains result in real changes to the way business is done, or will it just create more clutter the way email has created more clutter in our inboxes?
Interesting. But then on that topic, is it also fair to assume that what I love when you talk about AI, you're not just theoreticizing, right?
Yeah.
You're actually doing it, right? Is it fair to say that you're using a lot of these tools, right, in your day-to-day? You did not shrink your team, but it increased the productivity and you could actually grow and scale faster.
Yeah, so our team is small. We have a team of a handful of researchers. And so when we started using ChatGPT, GPT-4, Claude from Anthropic, we actually were able to delay two hirings. And that's just because the team themselves is so much more productive. The quality of their work is higher. They feel much more in control. And in some sense, they also have more time on their hands. I mean, it's worked very, very well for us, but we are really canonical desk workers, knowledge workers who trade in ideas. And it happens that LLMs are really, really good for that. Of course, across a large business, very few people are normally involved in processes like that. But I had a great example when I was in Germany just before coming into to Davos, which was the phone company had created a chatbot, a field service chatbot using an LLM for technicians as they sat by street side cabinets.
Right.
What do we need to do with this yellow cable and the green cable and the red cable? And it's actually sped up the work. It's meant that the field service agents are not sitting in the cold in a call center trying to get through to support. And that for me was a really great example. But can you apply that to a pharmaceutical company or an accounting firm? No, you have to have your own particular use case. It's very distinct.
And it's not just productivity. It's also allows people to have their jobs treated with respect in a way, right? So that they are not sitting in the cold if they don't have to, etc.
Yeah, I think it's a tremendously humanizing technology. We in the UK are coming off the back of a tremendous IT scandal called the Post Office Horizon IT scandal, where a billing system rolled out across the post offices had bugs in it, and several hundred post office workers were sent to prison wrongly for so-called fraud. And the point, when you look at the software, it was very, very dehumanized. It was the old style screen with a terrible UI, easy to make mistakes. The beauty of generative AI is that we get to talk to this thing in our natural language. It talks back to us in our natural language. It's the most natural thing in the world. And we can express politeness to it, and it can joke back to us.
Yep.
A couple of weeks ago, I finished a session with ChatGPT where I was looking at...
call it a session, you were conversing with
ChatGPT. And I was doing some work on pharmaceutical technology transitions, and I got tired. And I, at the end, I just whimsically said, "You're a very clever little robot. Thank you. And I'll come back tomorrow to talk about the moisture evaporators." Moisture evaporators is a phrase from Star Wars, Star Wars 1. Luke Skywalker has to fix them. I had not mentioned Star Wars. And ChatGPT responds, "Thanks. We had a productive session. And may the force be with you."
Love it.
And it figured that out. And that is incredibly humanized. I can't think of any other software that put a smile on my face in that way.
Love it. But then, like, how do I evolve that into the conversation on collective intelligence? Like, is that a first step towards that? How do you even think about collective intelligence?
Yeah, I think this is a really important point. When science fiction writers and computer scientists were thinking about AI, they often imagined it as a singleton. There would be a single AI that would almost be, you know, like a god somewhere. But I think what we're increasingly seeing is that the way we'll move towards a society of AI is in the same way that we've moved towards a society of databases. Our world lives on lots of databases that interact with each other better or for worse. And we are going to see a collective intelligence emerge, because every one of your clients and BCG itself will have hundreds of different AI systems, that are some of which are very deterministic, some of which are much more stochastic, like these LLMs. And they'll be interacting with us, they'll be interacting with each other, and things will feel smarter, and from that will come this sense of collective intelligence. It raises all sorts of really interesting questions about the governance of a distributed set of technologies that whose behavior is emergent, and questions of control as well, and predictability, which I think we will start to figure out over the coming years. But my sense is that we're going to move to a syncretic collective intelligence. I call it the society of AI.
Okay, so it's going to be a collection of these things that are going to have a perception of a collective intelligence, but it will be a lot of things.
There'll be a lot of different things. They'll be working together. And in fact, what I've just described is how human society works, right? We all have different capabilities, and then we sometimes cluster in groups that we call teams or work groups or companies that also have their own identity at a slightly higher, more meta level. And I think that those parallels are important, because they take away some of the anxiety people might feel about technologies like AI. They help us understand that we have actually got tools to make individual intelligences work together in healthy ways.
Yep. Well, Azeem, thank you. Thank you for joining me today. And even more importantly, thank you for being that collective intelligence that is unpacking all of this for us continuously, keeping us on our toes, and also, forcing our thinking and making sure we stay sharp. So thank you a lot.
No, thank you so much, Vlad. My pleasure.